one to the other.
And there's this point of no return, isn't there, Andrea?
Yeah, so we're talking a little bit about the fact that of sort of non-recoverable error and the idea that within sort of a process, not always, but you can find in some processes a defined point where you can no longer recover from error fast enough. Things
like
are happening too fast.
Once you jump out of the plane.
Right, once you jump out of the plane, yeah. But there's also, which I think is equally important, there's also a lot of times where you would not know where that point is, right? That point actually starts to occur organically because of other variables that are happening in the system. So we can't, the plan is never going to be perfect. And so actually our ability to learn and improve, learn and improve, learn and improve, and continually update how we understand things, how we talk to each other, even what that plan says is extremely important. This idea that, well, we're going to write it down, it's going to be perfect, and if people just followed it perfectly all the time, then nothing would go wrong. The difficulty is that there's just too much variability, and those things change all the time. If we have created a response to failure that allows us to, or even a response to success, I don't want to, but allows us to have those conversations, then we start to see all that variability and all of our plans improve. And I think that the part that was troubling to me at first was that I realized that my personal response, basically whether or not those other four principles that we just talked about, whether or not I believed in them, changed how I asked questions, and how I asked questions changed the response to those questions, because questions are fateful, which changed the information I had, which changed the solutions that I put in place, which actually changed the probability of whether somebody else would have the same outcome as the person that had before. So if that was an injury, I wasn't actually helping change the probability of that type of injury from happening again if I was asking questions that were focused on the person, on blaming the person, as opposed to understanding the system that makes it logical for people to make the decisions that they did. So that understanding of my biases and my perception of people within a system change reality of the physical system, which can change the future of whether or not somebody gets injured in something, is an enormous sort of feeling of responsibility. Of that response is so important because it actually will change what the physical world looks like in the future.
Right? And isn't it a massive opportunity? Though?
It is, though.
That's
right.
A huge opportunity. Yeah. It's a huge opportunity because what it allows you to do is that, and what organizations find that have really been diligent about changing the way that they make inquiries and ask questions is what they find is that they're not seen as intruders only to show on the scene when something has gone wrong, but guests and owners to observe how things go right. And that appreciation that, you know, error is everywhere, it's not too terribly interesting, and being very, very curious about how do we get this right most of the time shows you where your strength points are and the places where you can really improve. And I like to say that, you know, if you only show up when things go wrong, you know, you hardly have the, if you're not there when things are right, then you don't have the right to show up when things go wrong. And you're not, and you got your head in the sand.
So that's an interesting point that you mentioned before. It's not just response to failure, but it's also, there's a tremendous opportunity in response to success, or probably more accurately, response to normal. So like coming along and saying, okay, this has all gone great. Explain to me how this went great, and that's less scary than waiting for it to go completely wrong, and then going in and trying to change that hardwired way of approaching. Something's gone disastrously wrong. Someone must have done something terribly wrong. Okay, here's something, a situation which has been successful. Explain to us how this was successful, or how it went right or normal.
Show me what normal.
And then they can start to get an appreciation for this difference. There is basically an equivalence between success and failure, normal. And then they can start to get used to the idea, okay, so if that's the case in normal work every day, it's probably going to be exactly the same when things do go wrong. So it's a less threatening way to start learning how to use these different questions, you know.
I think this is where it begins to add value, you know, so a lot of safety, I'm not going to say programs, but you know, approaches have struggled with bringing value back into the system. So many ways it's seen as, well, we'll blame somebody, or you know, there's an outcome that's you know, some metrics or something like that. But what we're saying here is the value that comes from this approach is more than just safety. It's the outcome of good work, adding value back into the business, both financial but performance. So which I think is It's a much more receptive, or organisations much more receptive to this approach.
Yeah. You know. And it's funny, we did a role play yesterday where I had the opportunity to kind of go a little bit silly, and part of the role play was about the role of the person who does the normal work. And I hammed up the idea of expert, you know, 10,000 hours it takes to become an expert. And I think that approach, Andy, when you do that, what it inherently implies, you don't have to say it, but what it inherently implies is you are the expert in the success of this system.
It dignifies everyone else, the masses of the blue line.
And it puts that professional then no longer as the go-between between A and B, but allows them to step out of that loop and just stand from the sideline and help facilitate to get A and B, the work of the manager, starting to talk together in a way that's productive and adds value to both persons' worlds.
Yeah. The way I heard it described with an organisation I was working with recently, where there was a very, very much a clear focus, aligned with the principles of HOP, but they didn't call it HOP, right? So that's important as well, to make sure that this is not about having a label.
Right. Yeah.
And so we had the frontline expert talking about how they had drawn on frontline expertise to improve a bunch of things in their organisation. And their CEO came along to this session that we had, and I was kind of curious why the CEO was there. And the CEO just wanted to share the message that his role, was him in this case, but his role and the role of his management team was to get out of the way of the experts in the work and enable them to be more successful. And I fell off my chair.
Yeah.
Mm. What a great point to finish on.
Absolutely.
It is, absolutely.
Well done, everyone. May I just say that all of you are named Andy, so I'm here to represent the mentor, but we're not named
Don't call me Andy.